Fellow students at home, you are welcome to biology section. This time, if you can remember very well, we treated the skeletal system, supporting tissues in plants. We treated the digestive system and the ventral canal. We treated the transport system and also the excretory system. So this is for SS2, biology SS2 revision. So right now, I'm going to take questions on the alimentary canal. You can see the picture of the digestive system right in front of you. I remember very well, we've talked on all the organs of digestion, where digestion starts and where it ends. So we'll just pick questions on the digestive system that will help us understand digestion better. We'll start with what we call the sphincter muscle. The sphincter muscle. What is the sphincter muscle and where is this muscle located? The sphincter muscle is the muscle that allows the entrance of food into the stomach and out of the stomach. It is located at the edge, just the entrance of the stomach. You can see the sphincter muscle right there. This is where we have the sphincter muscle, at the entrance and then at the exit. Without the sphincter muscle, the food that comes from the esophagus cannot go into the stomach. And after digestion in the stomach, without the sphincter muscle, it's difficult for the stomach to allow the movement of already digested food from the stomach into the small intestine. So that's what the sphincter muscle is and what it does. The next question we are going to look at is, what is epiglottis? The epiglottis is a small cartilage that is found at the trachea. Remember I told you that we have two openings down here. We have the trachea, which is the windpipe, and we have the esophagus, which is the gullet. So the trachea has the epiglottis that covers it to prevent food from going into the windpipe, into the trachea. If food, any particle of food goes into the trachea, it makes you choke. And when you choke, you begin to cough. So the epiglottis covers the trachea. Then we look at what we call the hydrochloric acid. Why does the stomach secrete hydrochloric acid? Remember I told you we have hydrochloric acid secreted in the stomach. Why does the stomach secrete hydrochloric acid? Without the hydrochloric acid in the stomach, the enzymes secreted in the stomach cannot digest the food in the stomach. We have the renin and we have the pepsin. The renin and pepsin, remember we taught you that enzymes, all enzymes need a particular pH to operate. There are enzymes that operate under acidic medium and there are enzymes that operate under alkaline medium. So the renin and pepsin require acidic medium to be able to carry out digestion in the stomach. That is chemical digestion. So the hydrochloric acid enables digestion to take place in the stomach. Which two parts of the alimentary canal make up the small intestine? Look at the small intestine. The small intestine. The small intestine is made up of the ileum. You can see the ileum down there. It's made up of the duodenum. The duodenum comes first. This is the duodenum. And the latter part of the small intestine is the ileum. This is the duodenum. This is the duodenum. And this other part is the ileum. So the duodenum and the ileum. Actually, we have three parts that make up the small intestine. We have the duodenum first, we have the jejunum, and we have the ileum. So we have the duodenum, food goes into the duodenum first before passing to the jejunum and then to the ileum. Then the next one says, which two digestive juices are secreted into the duodenum? This is the duodenum. This is the duodenum. We have the pancreatic juice secreted into the duodenum and we also have the bile secreted into the duodenum. Now, what are the functions of these digestive juices? The pancreatic juice contains alkaline. It helps to neutralize the acid that comes from the stomach so that the enzymes that are secreted in the stomach can carry out digestion in the duodenum because we have a different set of enzymes in the duodenum. The same thing with the bile. The bile has three major functions. liver and stored in the gallbladder and then secreted into the duodenum. It has three major functions. The first thing the bile does, it neutralizes acid. So the acid that came with the food from the stomach is neutralized, and once it's neutralized, it's no more acid, it becomes alkaline, so that the enzymes in the duodenum can carry out digestion. Two, the bile adds water to chyme. Chyme is the nature of the food that comes from the stomach. After the food in the stomach has been digested, it's called chyme. So chyme, water is added to chyme and is changed to chyme. Then the third thing bile does is to emulsify fat. What is emulsification of fat? It helps to break down fat into droplets so that these fats can be digested. So those are the three major functions of the bile. Without pancreatic juice being secreted, the enzymes in the duodenum cannot function. The enzymes in the duodenum require an alkaline medium. Please don't forget that. It requires an alkaline medium to carry out their function. The next question says, what do feces contain? All right. Feces is the end product of digestion. After digestion has taken place, the digested food goes to the villi, absorption takes place. Feces is the undigested food. It is not everything that is digested and goes to the villi. The undigested food, the poo that comes out from your rectum is called feces. So it contains undigested food, it contains water, it contains roughages, fiber that leaves your body because the body doesn't need it. It leaves your body, goes through the colon, that's the large intestine, goes through the rectum and then out of your anus. So what comes out of your anus is actually food, but food that has not been digested. We want to look at this question on the board that will help us understand better. Number one, describe what would happen to a piece of stick. What is stick? Stick is meat. And a chip as they pass through a person's alimentary canal. A piece of stick contains protein. And a chip can be plantain chips, can be potato chips. A piece of chip contains oil, contains fat, and it also contains carbohydrate. Please don't forget that. Now, what will happen to this when it passes through a person's alimentary canal? The first thing you ask yourself is, my alimentary canal, what are the organs that make up my alimentary canal? The organs that make up your alimentary canal is your mouth, your esophagus, which we've seen already on the chart. Remember, the alimentary canal is made up of several organs. And you can see we have the mouth. That's the mouth here. We have the esophagus. We have the stomach. We have the small intestine. We have the large intestine, which goes to the rectum. Those are the organs that make up the alimentary canal. So when one is eating a piece of stick and a chip, what happens to it? First, let's know the enzyme that we have in the mouth, the function of the enzyme, and then we'll know what happens to what we eat. The enzyme secreted in the mouth is called ptyalin. And ptyalin helps to break down starch, cook starch, and convert it to maltose. Now, does any of this food contain starch? Yes, the chip contains starch. So once you eat stick and you eat chip, the chip, digestion of the chip begins first. The starch in the chip starts digesting first. So digestion of starch begins in the mouth. After the food has been eaten and ingested, it turns to what we call the bolus. It passes through the esophagus downwards. That downward movement is called peristalsis. It goes to the stomach and stays there for a few hours. Now, what happens to the stick and the chip that has entered the stomach? Remember that the chip has already started digesting. The starch in the chip has already started digesting. When it gets to the stomach, stick is made up of protein. And the enzymes in the stomach are renin and pepsin. Pepsin starts working on the stick. by converting it from protein to polypeptides in the stomach. So the digestion of the stick starts from the stomach. So from here you can see that digestion of protein starts from the stomach, while digestion of starch starts from the mouth. Remember I said start, I didn't say complete. It starts, it means it's continuous. Then from the stomach, after a few hours, the food moves to the duodenum. In the duodenum, we have three groups of enzymes secreted in the duodenum. The enzyme that digests fat starts from the duodenum, then continuation of protein and continuation of starch. So we have amylase. Amylase is secreted in the duodenum. What does it do? It helps in the continuation of the digestion of starch, which started initially here in the mouth. Then we have trypsin. Trypsin is an enzyme that works on protein. So it continues the digestion of protein that initially started in the stomach and converts it to polypeptides. Then we have lipase. Lipase is an enzyme that works on fat. It converts fat to fatty acid and glycerol. So you can see that the fat starts in the duodenum because that bile that was initially secreted has already helped to break down fat so that the digestion of fat can start. Then from the duodenum, the food, which is now chyle, as I initially explained, goes through the duodenum and then to the smaller, to the last part of the small intestine, which is called the ileum. In the ileum, we have several enzymes secreted. We have three groups of enzymes that complete the digestion of starch. We have another one that completes the digestion of protein, and we have another one that completes the digestion of fat. The ones that complete the digestion of starch are sucrase, we have maltase, and we have lactase. They complete the digestion of starch that initially started from the mouth, continued in the duodenum, and now in the ileum. Then we have erepsin, proteases. It completes the digestion of protein and converts it finally to amino acid. And then we have lipase that completes the digestion of fat, still to fatty acid and glycerol. The starch that completed digestion was converted to glucose. So at the end of digestion, the chip that you ate has been converted to glucose. That starch in the stick has been converted to glucose, while the fat in the stick, remember chips, you fry it in oil, the fat in the stick has been converted to fatty acid and glycerol. That's the end product of digestion. Then the stick that was eaten that contains protein, the end product, the final digestion that took place in the ileum, that protein has been finally converted to amino acid. Now after that, what happens? The amino acid, the glucose, and the fatty acid and glycerol goes through what we call the villi. Absorption takes place. It passes through the bloodstream and goes to the liver. Now, what has the liver got to do with this? The liver is not actually an organ of digestion. It doesn't carry out digestion. But at the end of digestion, it has a particular function it does in the body. What does it do? When the amino acid goes, has been absorbed by the villi, the glucose and the fatty acid and glycerol have been absorbed. What happens? Where do they go? They go to the liver. What does the liver do? The liver stores some of them. It converts some of them into other forms. It uses some of them and then sends them to the cells where they are required to function in the body. Like, what exactly does the liver do? For instance, glucose. Excess glucose cannot be stored just in the form of glucose. The liver converts excess glucose to glycogen and stores it in the body until the body needs glucose again. Then what happens to amino acid? Excess amino acid cannot be stored in the body. The liver breaks it down through a process called deamination. After the liver has broken it down, the kidney excretes it. You know, the body cannot use excess amino acid. So the kidney excretes it. It's a waste product. It's gotten rid of by the body. While the fatty acid goes to the adipose tissues under the skin and it's stored there. So that is the function of the liver. The already digested food goes to the liver. The liver works on them and sends them to the different parts of the body where they are required. So that is what happens to everything you eat. Now, the last question. Is it every food that is required, to undergo digestion? No. The only thing that digests in your body is protein, carbohydrate, fat, and oil. What about vitamins, minerals, and water? Mineral salts and water. They don't need to undergo digestion. They pass through the body. They don't require the digestive process. So vitamins do not go through digestion process. Mineral salts do not undergo digestion process. And water does not undergo digestion process.